start, I am really proud to say good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am really proud to see more gentlemen than ever before in this important discussion on a topic which is about women empowerment and women peace and security. Today I have an honor to ask to open this discussion Mr. Brian Schwartz, since I should say that Embassy of Canada has been already for several years great supporter of Riga Conference, great supporter of Latvian Transatlantic Organization, and a role model in implementing women, peace and security agenda, as well as role model in thinking about feminist foreign policy. Now, without wasting your time, please, I would like to ask Ambassador to give some opening words.
Good morning, Labrit. The honor is actually mine to be here with you this morning. I think the Latvian Transatlantic Organization, the Latvian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and Latvian Ministry of Defense have done a great job in bringing this together. I'm particularly pleased that there are two special sessions this morning focused on women, peace, and security. Sustainable peace is only possible when women are fully involved and empowered to participate in conflict prevention, conflict resolution, and post-conflict peace building. Women and girls are particularly vulnerable in conflict situations and are systemically targeted by those looking to use gender-based violence in conflict situations as an oppressive tool. While conflict may explode around, humanity is only present when the world attempts to prevent such violations, hold violators fully accountable, and support victims without stigmatization. Military, security, and enforcement organizations are most effective only when women are empowered at all ranks and are provided equal opportunities to contribute, to develop professionally, and to advance. Nations are only fully resilient when women are incorporated into the development and implementation of national response plans to conflict and to crises. Many experts on women, peace, and security have commented that the world is backsliding, with many atrocities showing a rise in targeted violence against women, rollback of rights, and ongoing exclusion. This is why we need to stand up for the women, peace, and security agenda now more than ever. We need to fight for these principles because they're not given. They're actively being taken away. We need to continue to push forward for meaningful inclusion of women in all aspects of security and peace. This is also why we need to continue to discuss the Women, Peace, and Security agenda at international security forum such as this. This is the fourth consecutive year that Canada is sponsoring a Women, Peace, and Security event at the Riga Conference. Today's special events will bring you panels of experts on empowering women and breaking barriers. These experts will share with you their experiences and reflections, and I'm certain that they will inspire all of us to continue. Since Canada became the framework nation of NATO's enhanced forward presence in Latvia, the relationship between Canada and Latvia has grown from one of friendship to one of close, trusted partnership. Our two countries have expanded our relations beyond the NATO framework, and we work directly and bilaterally on many different issues. As Sigita mentioned, one of the great examples is on women, peace, and security. In 2011, Canada launched its first national action plan on women, peace, and security. We launched our second in 2017. We're due for our renewal. During that time, Canada worked closely with Latvia to draw on Canada's expertise and experience to assist Latvia in developing their own national action plan. Fast forward a few years, we're now both working on our third iteration, together as peers, learning from each other. This is just one example that I wanted to raise because I imagine that the people here in the crowd, people watching online, are very much involved in international organizations, defense organizations, security organizations, academia, think tanks. There are opportunities like this for us to promote this agenda. We shouldn't look at it as a separate agenda to promote, but agenda that's integrated in all of our interests and all the things that we do. So as you listen to the experts, the experiences that you will hear about over the next 2 hours, I ask you to reflect on that, keep that in your mind after this conference and in your work moving forward. Thank you very much for attending, for listening, and I do look forward to the conversations to come. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, esteemed panelists, dear guests. My name is Andrej Spildagovic. I'm Ambassador at Large at the Latvian Foreign Ministry on Global and Multilateral Affairs. It's a crispy morning here in Riga, but certainly a very warm welcome to this opening panel on the empowering of women through the turbulent times of war. This panel, as Ambassador Schwartz just mentioned, will be mostly concentrated on the Women, Peace and Security agenda. And the gains, what we have accumulated over the last 2 decades since adoption of the groundbreaking UN Security Council Resolution 1325, which was adopted unanimously at the UN in 2000. And also we will address the headwinds, the setbacks and pushbacks, which we have been facing for this agenda over the last few years. This is certainly a very important priority for Latvia. It has been for a few years, but of course the war in Ukraine, Russia's aggression of Ukraine, has made this subject even much more pertinent. For Latvia, as Ambassador mentioned, it's been a priority for partnerships with many countries, with Canada, with Norway. At the UN, we have partnered with countries like Liberia, the Maldives, cross-regionally. I am glad that this initiative, this resolution, is still quite widely supported by the UN membership, but the challenges are quite considerable. Of course, the war-torn environment where women warriors are facing challenges is one set of problems, issues we have to address. And also quite dramatic slide in terms of the position of women, human rights for women and girls in many parts of the world. I wouldn't want to over-dramatize the challenges in this early morning, but of course, return of Taliban in Afghanistan, pandemic of coup d'etats in Africa, Russia's war on Ukraine and escalation of violence in the Middle East are just a few setbacks which we are facing. Today, we would like to discuss what ought, should, could be done to address those challenges. And I'm very grateful for the panelists, which have a wealth of experience in the field and very dedicated to the promotion of women, peace and security agenda. To my right, I would like to introduce Major General Jette Albinus, commanding officer of Multinational Division North, based here in Adaji in Latvia. General Albinus has had an illustrious career in the Danish Armed Forces that included deployments to Bosnia. She has worked as a military advisor to the African Union, as well as a commanding officer to the Danish Battalion in Kosovo. Among other responsibilities, General Albinus is an executive board member of the National Olympic Committee and Sports Confederation of Denmark. To my left is Mr. John Barter, Senior Vice President of GLOBSEC from Bratislava, Slovakia. Mr. Barter is a seasoned defense and security professional with 17 years as a commissioned officer at the UK Royal Air Force, followed by 21 years in the defense industry. Mr. Barter joined GLOBSEC in 2019 and has been actively involved in this organization, defense initiatives, and chairs the Defense Roundtable at the annual GLOBSEC Forum. I intend to have two topics to introduce this panel. The first, I will start with more general description of the challenges, what WPS agenda is facing. And the second line of questions will be more specific to, as we say, to the country-specific situations. And of course, for Latvia, this is Ukraine, a country which is, has been under enormous strains lately, facing unprovoked, unprecedented invasion from Russia, which we are trying to support in every way, including WPS agenda. So let me start with a more general question, first to General Albinus. What, in your opinion, are the most significant challenges faced specifically by women in armed forces and also in war-torn environments?
Thank you so much. And first of all, thank you for inviting me to this great conference. Actually, I think that the overall environment, no matter whether we talk the armed forces, we talk about being abroad in different kind of non-governmental organization, it is actually the environment you are entering that can be the biggest challenge. If I start with my with the military part, I think in the majority of all armed forces, they have been developed by men. They had been, you know, the workplace for men for more than 50-100 years. And due to that, the culture, the way of speaking, the way of having social activities and so on, are of course based on what they found pleased them. So when you enter as a young female, again, it could be an NGO or it could be as an officer, you don't fight these things, because when you choose a profession, you choose a profession because you are attracted by the profession. In my case, because you wanted to be a soldier. In other cases, maybe because you want to be a doctor who make a difference. And then you don't fight the settings if the setting doesn't fit you, because you won't, you wouldn't like to have that, you can say, brand on you. You want to be accepted for what you're doing. It also means that in many cases, you have to either have been there for a long time before you start saying, okay, should we look into the environment? So the environment is more open, it's more attractive for all different kinds of gender and diversity. Because when it comes back to the main thing, I think it's about to have diversity in the workplace, in the decision making, and therefore you should make sure that your work environment actually can attract that diversity. Instead of what we often do, we focus a lot of, in this case, female or other things, to make sure that, you know, we can cope with the challenge we meet. Could be nice if it was the other way around. I think I will stop here. I can talk a long time about that. So to translate it into a broader context, and not only military, look at the environment, look what you are up against. And if you really want, as an organizer, in any kind of organization, to have more diversity, you have to look at your culture.
Thank you so much, Madam General. I think in Latvia, we are fairly proud by the current numbers. 17% of our armed forces represented by female soldiers. You have served in conflict areas. You have been advising African Union. Could you share your impressions, your experience, how this agenda is impactful, how successful it has been in on the ground?
Yeah, I think in if we talk about war fighting, in most environments, I have felt accepted as a female, because as long as you are at least among colleagues, no matter where they come from, they know that it requires something to get at that level or having the skills you have. But it's also because I come from a country where we are brought up with, you know, that small boys and girls, they can do the same. We have the same possibilities. And it has also been that, even though I've been in the Danish Armed Forces for more than 35 years, that actually if my body and my brain could cope with it, I could go wherever I wanted. So often when I go abroad, I have been in the military context, met with, oh, was you really an infantry officer? Did you really do war fighting? I think Denmark was among the first one who actually had combat soldiers in Afghanistan. But for me, because I came from that environment, it was not something. So very often I had to think about, okay, people actually, you know, wonder about these things. People might have an opinion about these things. But due to that, I came from an environment where it was possible. I didn't think so much about it. And in many cases also when I've been deployed, you know, I didn't think about I was female because I looked at myself when I took on my uniform that I was an officer, right? This was what I wanted to be. This was what I wanted to be accepted for. I never joined the armed forces to be the first female something. Well, I wanted to be a soldier. So it's more often people's reaction to me. And an example from real life was when I was deployed to Bosnia as a young captain, as working in intelligence. I had a Polish lieutenant colonel. He only saw my rank and my last name. And the first thing he said when he saw me was, "What the hell, you are a woman?" And I said, "Oh, yeah, yeah, oh, yeah." And I didn't know quite what to answer. We came along quite well. And I think for him, it was just a way of, he was, you know, he was caught by surprise that, you know, okay, he could be a female officer. And then they often start worrying about, okay, do I need to do something so I can make sure that she actually can fulfill her task? And then they start thinking about that instead of what I would have preferred, just to continue doing whatever they had been doing. So often it's more surprise to the surroundings than it is to yourself.
Thank you, General. I would like also to recognize that this WPS agenda, of course, it's not limited only to the governments, but I want to acknowledge huge support of NGOs, of the business, of academia to promotion of this policy and also for many, many important actions on the ground. Mr. Barter, how can the international community better support and empower women in conflict zones, ensuring their meaningful participation in peace building and conflict resolution processes?
Well, firstly, everybody, good morning, and it's a pleasure to be in Riga for the first time.
Pleasure.
And we're talking about one of my passions because I head up in the organization, our initiative, CEHER, which is all about empowering and developing women leaders for the future. I think on the Article 1325 you mentioned, I think it's great that the UN has unilaterally signed this off, but I need to recognize that the UN is a broken organization while Russia is still part of it. And there's a lot more to do. I think also, if we had proper gender balance representation in politics, governments, and business, maybe there actually would be less conflicts and wars. And I really think that is an important thing. And the general said something very important when we were chatting in the green room, that it actually starts at a young age. You know, I see the Central European mothers, their sons do nothing, the daughters do everything. And I see a difference between guys who maybe, like myself, lost their fathers very young and were raised by very strong women who were driving forward, running businesses and everything else. So the perception starts at a very young age. I think on Ukraine, and I'm a bit more focused on Ukraine because we've got an office there and we've been doing a lot of work with the Ukrainian government. And I think the points I'd like to touch on is their success has been because of really total society defense, which includes women leadership across the whole spectrum, not only in government, but also operationally as well. Regarding the challenges, it's very hard for a guy to talk about the challenges women face because we're most free more of the responsibility for them facing the challenges, let's be honest. So when the time is right, I would like to more focus on Ukraine and the women leaders and the examples and where they're heading in dealing with things like demining PTSD. But for the moment, we'll stop that there and come to that later.
Thank you so much. We got one question from the audience. Maybe both of you could reflect a bit. How can we better include young girls and adolescents in women's empowerment efforts? And what benefits can this early involvement yield in the long run? Any thoughts?
Yeah, I might come back to one of my earlier points. But also, I think if we have to include the younger females, we might need to do things differently. Again, it's come back, and of course, there's a different which organization we are talking about. But if we talk about the armed forces, you know, when probably my generation and also the ones that was coming after, they were still presented for the same way of doing things. and nobody, you know, kind of took a step back and said, okay, do we need to do this differently? So I think the first reflection I would ask for and what we could do is actually take a step back, ask ourselves, why are we doing things the way we are doing it? Could we do it differently? And it should not be, you know, me, even though I'm a female, telling my organization how we should invite young female in the armed forces. We should actually go out and ask the young, even though they're not in the armed forces yet, and ask, okay, what should we do to make it attractive for you? And then later we can tell them, okay, this is what we can offer. I think we have to be very much aware of that the majority of decision makers belongs to one generation and the young ones to another. So I think we should be much better in asking the younger generation, what can we do? What are your requirements? A good example is also, you know, for 20 years ago, female was the only one that, you know, took time off when they had small children. Now, at least in my country, all the young men, also in the armed forces, want to take time off with their kids, right? And all our regulations are based on some stuff that goes 20 years back. And I think we can cope that also to governmental organization, because again, the environment was based on another way of living, right? So that should be my recommendation.
Thank you very much. And I just want to add that we certainly should not rest on our laurels. Same goes for WPS, same goes for women empowerment in all other avenues, including women in diplomacy or women in science, women in technology. Many things might seem very self-evident for us, but from my experience at the UN, I have been championing women in diplomacy, for example, because there are still many steel floors and glass ceilings around, and this understanding that half of humanity cannot be excluded from the development is still has not trickled down in every country and every place around the world. If I can move our discussion a little bit more to Ukraine, of course I want to recognize heroic struggle of Ukrainians and particularly women warriors in this country, and our society, Latvian business, Latvian government has been supporting incredibly, they fight for survival, but of course this fight brings a lot of challenges, a lot of tests for mental resilience, for post-traumatic traumas, post-conflict traumas, for rehabilitation, medical treatment. Would you like, Mr. Barter, to share your analysis, your observation, and maybe your remedies, what has to be done in that regard?
My pleasure. I'm not sure I'll have remedies, but I've got some good examples. But can I just come back to the question that was asked?
Please.
Just make one short comment. That I think that what we need to do to make and motivate young women is to give them the feeling that success and women leadership is normal, and it is standard, and it starts with the politics. In Europe, unless we don't have gender balanced governments, then the starting point isn't there. It's very good the EU have dictated, I think it's by 2026, that all boards should have 40% representation of women, except for SMEs, which I understand. Personally, I'd prefer if it was worded as board should be balanced 55-45 with no mention of gender, because that would actually then be really, really sensible. But coming over to the points in Ukraine, and I'll get to the points quite quickly. So I would like to cover perhaps four areas very briefly. Female leadership in Ukraine, and I'm going to refer to a book by Victoria Potratis, which is called Invincible, which is I highly recommend. It's a series of interviews with a number of women who are actively involved in the fight in Ukraine. Demining is something which in Ukraine is a really, really serious issue. A lot of men and a lot of financiers are talking about rebuilding Ukraine. There's no rebuilding until demining. And this is where we are actively seeing women taking a true leadership role today. PTSD, this really is in Ukraine, it's a whole society going to be affected. And it's also going to stretch to Europe. because families have moved to Europe and veterans are going to be moving to Europe to be with their families. This is not just a Ukrainian problem, it's a European problem. And then a few words on something which is so serious, and this is Russia's weaponization of sexual abuse by the Russian army. And we've just must touch on that. So let's look at examples. Well, in Ukraine, I'm going to start at the top. First Lady Olena Zelenska, she was a reluctant First Lady at first. And then you saw her step up to the mark, going to the UN, going to the US. She had her First Lady and Gentleman conference in Kiev just in August. We launched our PTSD report there. And her leadership has definitely inspired people to make a difference. Yulia Seredenko, she's first Vice Prime Minister and Minister of Economy. Now, we published a report on demining, which is a key topic I'm involved in. And she asked us to form a task force, internationally led, to sort out the rules and regulations. And all the people driving this and leading it are female. The head of the task force is a truly inspirational female leader who I get a lot of advice from, which is Kolinda Grabar-Kitarović, fourth president of Croatia. And she is actually part of the Globsec team leading that to make a difference. Now, not only do we see women taking a role in the strategy for demining, the priorities, and this is humanitarian demining, I stress, rather than combat demining, but actually, at the moment, it appears to be 40% of women are becoming deminers in Ukraine. And actually, their attitude and aptitude and skill sets make them very, very suitable, most probably because of their natural patience. But this is one thing we're seeing a true leadership role. Another in Ukraine is that if I look at the parliament, there's only 20% female representation. But if you look at the active output, it is the female MPs which are leading the way. For instance, Maria Mezanova, who's often, who I think is speaking at this event later, she is extremely active along with her colleagues. And this is setting a really, really good example. Now let's look at the Ukrainian army. 60,000 plus women, 43,000 in combat roles, 7,500 in senior leadership roles. It's very, very impressive. And in Victoria's book, Invincible, which I mentioned, this not just covers the women in combat, it covers the women who are running companies, supporting the army, raising money internationally, delivering aid. I mean, when you see we delivered 3,000 tons in 1 week, that's leadership, that's impact. And there's women on the front line who are mothers making documentary films to document the sexual abuse and everything else that's going on. These women are really stepping up to mark. And when I read the book, there was one lady who stood out to me. And this is Yulia Mikhotenko. She's a warrior. There's just no doubt about it. Originally joined the Ukrainian army in 2016. Then after her husband was killed in action in 2018, started working as a platoon commander at the training school. Then she left for a bit. Straight after the invasion, she rejoined. And she's an officer serving on the front line. I need to read my notes now because there's a quote, which was, after the interview for this book, the indestructible Julia had a combat mission in eastern Ukraine. She says, men's attitude has changed on the front line. I'm now treated as a professional and command the respect I have earned as a combat veteran. So this is where women like this are showing really effective leadership. And the point when you read the book more, you learn that the men actually want to be part of a unit because she is the best at what she does. There's many more stories, I won't go into them. Now on PTSD, this is a big issue in Ukraine and it's going to affect the whole Europe. Now, women typically, from our research, have 2 to 3 times more cases of PTSD than men. And a lot of that is because of the environment and the type of experiences they feel in war. And obviously, the highest rate of PTSD cases relate to sexual abuse and violence. And I mentioned before that Russia's weaponization of sexual abuse is a deliberate strategy. It's horrifying. Women are raped, children are raped, simply to make sure that they will never engage in sexual activity again, to actually stop people reproducing in Ukraine. Young men are tortured and castrated and sent back to Ukraine. It's horrific. So when we look at this, and I will finish by looking at an OMI poll, which may be at events I've said that Russia is a rogue state, the nation is sick, and this is how I feel. And because I can work for an NGO, I can actually say that. 53% of Russians think the Russian invasion of Ukraine has bolstered its international standing and that other countries will now take Russia's demand more seriously. So I think, just to summarize, there are many women leaders who punch above their weight. The world is a very dangerous, unstable place. It's morally bankrupt, and we need women to take up leadership roles to actually change the world. And that's where I sit.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Barter, for very, very important points, and of course, for very valuable research, what is being done by GLOBSEC in this regard. You made a reference to UN. I am not a UN official. I am used to be Latvian ambassador to the UN. And I agree that the organization is not in the best shape. And of course, we hardly see any unanimous resolutions anymore for very well-known reasons. But I would still want to stress that UN is needed and UN is invaluable because for the same reason that UN helps to expose those crimes. And UN makes a very important job to document those crimes, and particularly conflict-related cases of sexual violence. As of today, we know more than 125 well-documented cases, and they are also, we are here in Latvia, we also support that effort. Latvia hosts more than 30,000 Ukrainian refugees, and a number of Latvian NGOs, including quite famous one, Marta, is helping survivors of the conflict to rehabilitate here in Latvia. And we definitely support every effort, be it International Criminal Court, be it international organizations, documenting those war crimes. And we certainly are calling to the world community to set up a special tribunal for the crime of aggression. We believe that peace and development is not possible without accountability, without stopping impunity. And I think every effort in documenting those crimes is very important, and I think your contribution is very valuable in this regard. General, would you like to add any reflections from your experience in conflict zones, what Ukraine can benefit?
I think right now what's happening in Ukraine is, forcing a development that many of us luckily haven't been in. In my case, it has been close to when I have been deployed, when you kind of experience how you work in an environment. But I think that's what I have tried a couple of times, because sometimes you are uncertain when you have to go out and meet people and you're the only female. But then of course you have planning tools and you have people around you that, you know, make sure you can try to protect yourself. Doesn't mean that you can protect all females, but we have to be realistic that, unfortunately, as described by John, this is what happened. It's sometimes the opponent's tactic, and then we have to plan for that. So we make sure that, you know, our, at least the female we have in our armed forces are protected, but also when we do planning in general, what can we do to try to protect the civilian population? It's still a requirement we have. Unfortunately, we don't see it carried out that well, not only in Ukraine, I think also about the current conflict in Israel. So I think it's important that we do what we can and realize that this is a threat. That being said, and you asked me also about reflections and about leadership, and was a little bit inspired by John's example. I think the majority of us, when we do this kind of leadership and we end in an environment like that, many of us are forced to be quite authentic. If you take me as an example, not only am I female, I'm also a very short cubby. So, you know, I couldn't stand up in front of my soldiers and, you know, show my 2 meter tall figure, and they would be scared by that. I had to make sure that the soldiers trusted me. And I think very early on, it forced me to stand by who I was, figure out what's worked for me. And I think many females who are entering different environments have or learn very early on what is my forces, how am I authentic, and then they learn to use that. And by doing so, can also underline what John said, it actually makes you maybe on the longer term a better leader, because you can't copy anyone, because there's no one to copy. You have to figure out what's worked for you, and you have to make sure that you know you're not only a good and skillful leader, but you also can create fellowship. And a great, I think, requirement for doing so is to be authentic. And I think many girls are forced to do that early on because we can't copy, there's no one to copy. So a few reflection on that.
Thank you, Madam General. We have the third panelist now with us, Mrs. Irene Felin, NATO's ASG's Special Representative for Women, Peace and Security, is joining us from Brussels online. Mrs. Felin is a native of Bolzano, Italy. Mrs. Felin studied conservation of cultural heritage and museology and started her career at the Italian Ministry for Foreign Affairs. Later on, Mrs. Felin founded the Italian chapter of Women in International Security, an organization dedicated to advancing the leadership and professional development of women in the field of international peace and security. Mrs. Felin, you probably have followed our discussion. We have touched on the 23rd anniversary of UN resolution on women, peace and security. We talked a little bit country specifically about Ukraine and conflict related sexual violence. And if I may ask you, can you provide examples of women-led networks or organizations that have effectively mobilized resources during wartime? We discussed support to Ukraine. We discussed support to the Women, Peace and Security agenda across different international organizations. Could you share your view on these issues? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me apologize for the delay in which I connected. I was to have the opportunity to participate, if only virtually, to this important conversation, which is very timely for several reasons. You already mentioned we are approaching the anniversary of the adoption of the resolution 1325. Indeed, I'm about to leave to go fly to New York, where the entire global community engaged in the promotion of the implementation of the agenda of women, peace and security will be present, both at the institutional and level, and also from civil society. And then this network and women, and I'm very proud to share my previous experience before I became a special representative with the reality of women networks and how I also I'm trying to engage in the same way under my remit now as a special representative for NATO. We know that the agenda came a grassroots organization moving during the 90s and reaching the point of the highest political point, bringing this topic into the Security Council in the year 2000 for the adoption of Resolution 1325. In the past 23 years, there have been these two track, I would say, work. On one side, an increasing commitment from a national level, from regional organizations, security organizations, such also NATO that started the development and adoption of first policy in 2007, but at the same time, the community of women working made efforts to implement these words into concrete actions. And this is clear that those tools of women networks are essential at any level. What is happening in at a global level in the international community in the past decades, a little bit less than decades, I would say starting especially in 2015, is this much very interesting bring women together, but they are connected, so they are semi-governmental organizations being connected with different ministries of foreign affairs and working close in close synergies also with UN women and different organizations. And I think that this element is extremely important, because we know that the problem here is not that there are no women expert on there is a lack of commitment, but there is very often a lack of political opportunities. As networks and having an impact only on the community level, we will meet a gap, which is the, how to bridge and bring this very political, very important work at community level with the at the decision making. And in order to do that, we need to create the right platform. And the message I would like to share is that we need to do this in peacetime. We cannot fix problem during our embedding in the societies, and we need to address them during the women and those networks can really operate when war is present. I'm also trying to be part of this effort in my role today as special representative here at NATO. We have my predecessor and the Alliance has created a formal tool of a network of civil society representatives, women engaged in the promotion of women, peace and security. And I'm happy to share that I'm relaunching the network with a new group of expertise in the coming weeks, and the group will help me in my strategic thinking and see how NATO can improve the commitment in Israel. And of course, a lot of our thinking will be on Ukraine, an area where I have been engaged closely from the military and the political side, but also civil society. Interesting to see how this network can support the work of the Alliance in the coming months.
Thank you so much, Madam. And I want to reassure you that Latvia is very active in New York. We are members of the board of Committee on the Status of Women, and also we are on the board of UN Women, main UN agency dealing with the women promotion issues. So we are fully dedicated to this agenda. We have a few minutes to open the floor for questions from the audience. Please raise your hand, identify your affiliation. Please, are any questions on the topics raised in the room? I don't see. Yes, please.
Let me introduce myself. I'm Yulia Paskevska from Ukraine. And for me, it's very pleasant to be here. And it's not a question, it's only small comments. I want to say thank you for your solidarity. Thank you that you are staying with us and that you pay a lot of attention to this very important maybe not situation, not question, it's important a big important things to whole world, not only for Ukraine, not only for Baltic cities, it's about whole world. That's why for me really it's very important that we discuss about peace, we discuss about this security, because now it's time to be attention to another strategy and looking forward to this strategy to whole world and pay attention a lot of to the security. I was a professor of the Department of Security, National Security, National Guard, and before the war, and I work with a lot of coursant soldiers, and now I am very proud they are ready to be fighting in this situation. That's why we should be ready to the future, and thanks a lot that we pay attention for women, because it's really now it's agency of changers, and it's a big support for Ukrainian women also. Thank you very much for solidarity. Yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions from the audience? Yes, please, on the right side.
Yes, good morning, colleagues. Maria Mezentseva, MP from Ukraine. And I'll have a very technical question. You know, time is running fast. We are looking at different developments now in the Middle East, which might affect the full scene of the possible World War III or whatever the media is portraying it right now. Do you think we're technically ready for further enlargement of the NATO, OTAN? I mean, the possible membership of Ukraine at the coming Washington summit, which has had a Vilnius one, where the agreements were reshuffled a little bit and we have been given more perspective. But do you think that it's timely and needed right now, looking at the how aggression of Russia affected to the enlargement of first Finland and Sweden on the way, surely? Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Filin, would you like to comment a question about enlargement of NATO? Can we put on sound?
Ukraine have been taken step by step by... you can't hear me?
Yes, we can. Please. Please. Please, please go on. Please, please.
There is a problem with the sound. Can you...
Now it's fine, please. Please proceed.
They can? Okay. I don't hear. So this has been taken in the Vilnius summit, and the question of the timing and when it will happen, it's something that is discussed with Ukraine and by the decision that will be taken by allies in the due time. There is no the events that are happening at global level, but they're part of a conversation that is happening directly with President Zelensky in the frame of the NATO-Ukrainian Council.
Any other views from the panelists on that?
I've certainly got a view on this. I mean, Ukraine has earned its place in NATO. It has a lot to teach NATO in the future. This is going to be a protracted war. We need to move forward with a clear path for NATO membership for Ukraine. I was in Finland the other week, and it's obvious that there is so much NATO can learn from what the Finnish can do, which is going to be the same for Ukraine. And quite honestly, accelerating Ukraine's membership in NATO is not going to escalate the conflict. It's not going to escalate any future war in the world, if anything. It's most probably going to make people take a step back and actually think. So I can only see that it needs to move forward. President Macron at Globsec was very clear. Ukraine should be part of NATO. And in the meantime, there has to be security guarantees offered to the parts of Ukraine which are not currently occupied by Russia.
I can just add that Latvia's national position is very well known and very clear. We support NATO enlargement. We support Ukraine's membership. We know from our own historical experience that gray situations, kind of unclear situations, create vacuum, and they serve as an invitation for resurgent Russia to move in. So we certainly believe that clarity and support to Ukraine to this goal should be a priority. And we clearly acknowledge enormous sacrifice of Ukrainians in attaining this goal. So we hope that it will come sooner than later. Please, another question from the left.
Hello, I'm Patricia. I'm from the IMS Gender Advisors Office at NATO. I have a question a little bit on the points that were discussed about culture change. And you talked a lot about the external reactions from men that you've worked with. I'm wondering, how can we change this culture change, and how do we bring men in as part of this conversation? Because WPS still is very sidelined and seen as a woman's issue, when I really think this is really everyone's issue.
Yeah, thank you so much. And I fully agree. It's everyone's issue. And actually, I think we need to solve it in common. It's not our task to solve it. It should be a common interest. Sometimes I felt, and again, sorry for it's only based on my personal experiences, but sometimes you need to give examples, because I don't feel in general that my male colleagues are against it. But sometimes, because they're brought up in, they can't by themselves see what changes they actually need to make. That's why we need to do it together. Let me give you a very basic example. How many times have you received invitation where, if you look at the dress code, it says jacket and tie? You just, you know what it means. You try to do something. It's a very, very small issue, and none of us say anything. But let me give you an example, and I think that's the way we have to turn this around. If you then in the same invitation write with dress code, you have to wear a skirt and a blouse, I guarantee you will have a reaction. And if you then say, okay, so this is actually what we've been living with for 13 years. If you think it doesn't matter, then you wouldn't react, right? I think we need to come forward also with some more or bigger issues than my example here, but it's actually, I think, a way of showing and a way of telling, this is how we need to work. We need to find all these small issues so it's open and everybody feels welcome and don't have to think about what does it mean for me. I don't know how many ties I have received during my career, not because people don't want to give me a gift, they haven't thought about it. They haven't even thought about that it could be a female among, right? So you receive a tie. It doesn't matter, you can throw it away, but I think over the years, and again, it's the amount of examples. So we need to solve it together. And we need, as female, and I can also look back in my own career and say, as I said in the beginning, I didn't say anything for the first 20 years because I didn't want to be the one talking about female, right? I want to be a professional soldier. I know now that I have a responsibility, and I have a big responsibility for pointing out even the small issues, because only by doing so we can together change it.
Thank you. Mr. Barter?
I can't really comment on that, but there's one thing I would like to pick up on that you mentioned, because you mentioned Latvia's support for the special tribunal, which Ukraine wants to set up. And I've been discussing with this, and it's supported in Central Europe, it's supported in France, but many nations are pushing back against it and saying we have the International Criminal Court. Now, all I'd like to say to people that the message I use is all Ukraine wants is what the UK had after World War II. And it's something that needs to be encouraged. And we need women to take leadership and drive this forward, because at the end of the day, I find it very difficult personally that I've met resistance in the UK for getting a parliamentary resolution to support this. And obviously countries like Latvia, France are moving forward.
Thank you. Madam Filin, would you like to comment on the question from the audience?
Because I have some problems with the audio. Can you hear me now?
Yes, please. We hear you clearly.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, we can. Yes.
Yes. Okay, yes, sure. I think the question on the culture is cultural change is extremely important. At the end, it's all about the cultural change, as I mentioned before, the patriarchal culture and the different attitude that we see. I see that things are changing. I have the impression, fortunately, this change is slow, and maybe we don't have time to wait until the process is done. But compared to 15, 20 years ago, when I started engaging this topic, where I was engaging only with women in those networks, now, especially in a context such as at NATO, I have many more male colleagues coming together and working, being committed to better understand and to better implement the agenda. And I think that when it comes to this concept, we always emphasize the operational effectiveness. What I have learned that while we work with men that have not been exposed to this kind of messages before, we need to really make clear why we are doing this. On one side is a question of values, and this is part of the core values of the Alliance. In this new strategic concept, it is clearly emphasized that gender, the advancement gender equality is a reflection of this is in the field of armed forces to better operate. But I see this also in our everyday life, in families. We are better if we work together, if we work in synergy, if we have gender equality in place in our family and in our society. And I think that this is the message we have to share every day with our colleagues. Because I would like to say that not only women share the same, embrace the agenda in the same way. Still very often women, especially women in power, are adopting a male model of leadership. Because it's different to bring a different narrative. It's very difficult. So it takes courage, it takes a lot of self-confidence. And as it is said, very often women are alone in the room where important decision is taken. It is not an easy position to bring the different messages. It's extremely important to be part of this change.
Thank you so much. From my point, maybe a personal reflection, I think a few years ago, 5-10 years ago, in this country, in Latvia, we certainly, the WPS agenda has been taken as a kind of more abstract, more dry, theoretical subject, but as an intended consequence of the Russia's aggression against Ukraine, I think awareness of the society has increased considerably, particularly seeing the fight, what Ukrainian people are having, all society approach, that has raised awareness and the need for much more thorough consideration, training, understanding and discussion. We see quite a significant surge of women applications in the armed forces for all kinds of trainings. And there is a quite positive also reaction by the male soldiers. And this is a kind of new synergy which is being evolved. And I think the level of participation of civil society also has increased considerably. So when we see that stakes are so high, peace and security are not abstract, but quite existential considerations, then things also start to change. I see that we have exhausted our time, so I will not make any official conclusions, but I want to thank our panelists for incredible generosity of sharing your experience, your research, your role models in this regard. And from Latvian side, I want to stress that this is an important subject for Latvia. We support it in the country. We support it outside of our borders, in NATO, in the European Union, in the UN. Latvia aspires for the first time the seat at the UN highest table, Security Council, with elections in June 2025. And if elected, we certainly will continue to advocate for WPS in New York and across the globe. I thank you, and I wish everyone successful continuation of the Riga conference. Thank you.
Thank you very much.